In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Tired of having to have the same conversation with them over and over and over again.
Pain, anger, and exhaustion. With no officers held directly accountable for Breonna Taylor's killing, people say enough is enough. Tonight on Primetime, what they want that change to look like.
A Clayton County man accused of going on a rampage, shooting three women and a child, how deputies finally tracked him down.
And a woman who couldn't wait to be a mother dies from COVID-19 shortly after giving birth. Why her family hopes others will take her story to heart.
11 Alive News Primetime on the ATL starts now.
Well, here we are. We're sitting in Midtown right now, and the rain is getting heavier, and storms also are getting more intense, we understand. Let's go to meteorologist Samantha Moore. She's in the Storm Tracker Center with what we can expect the rest of the night. Doesn't look very good from what I'm seeing there.
Yeah, a lot of green on the radar, Jeff. It's going to end up getting heavier as far as the rainfall the next few hours, as what is left of Beta, now a post-tropical depression, is moving across northern Alabama. And ahead of that, we're seeing all this rain moving in right now, along with that very strong line that's moving through eastern Alabama. So this is the line we're going to be watching on approach this evening. And ahead of it, a good swath of moisture coming in out the Gulf of Mexico. So we have showers from Peachtree City into Atlanta. We had some heavy downpours earlier. Haven't had much lightning yet, but I think that may change as that line approaches during the early morning hours. We also have some heavy downpours here now. You're here on the north side, heading in towards Lake Lanier, heading towards Gainesville at this hour. And as we pull out, you can see that that line is shaping up pretty nicely right now with a lot of lightning right along the southern flank. So we'll likely see some of that moving in as we head into the overnight. So the showers are going to be pretty scattered across North Georgia in the next few hours with some embedded heavier downpours. And then as we head towards 11 o'clock, 11:30, in comes the really heavy stuff in through Dalton, in through Rome, and then into Carrollton as it pushes to the east. So don't be surprised if you hear some very heavy rain on your rooftops, as well as you may have a little bit of lightning with some of these storms as they move on through. The winds are going to be gusty as well. Now, right now, the max sustained winds with this depression are around 25 miles per hour. As it moves to the east, it'll bring those winds into North Georgia. So 27 mile per hour winds possibly in Rome, 29 mile per hour winds in Blairsville. So it's going to be gusty, and that could bring a few limbs down, possibly some weakened trees down as well as we head into the overnight hour. So it's primarily going to be an overnight event in terms of the wind and the heaviest of the rain. And then we're going to be dealing with widespread cloud cover and fog. So coming up, what you can expect for Friday and how things are going to be shaping up for this first weekend of fall.
There is tension in cities across the country tonight. People still feeling the weight of the decision not to charge three Louisville officers directly with shooting and killing Breonna Taylor. Instead, former officer Brett Hankison was now indicted on lesser charges. People in Louisville gathering around Taylor's memorial once again tonight.
Last night we saw a movement re-energized as people marched for justice. In Louisville, marches at one point became violent. Two officers were injured in a shooting, not life-threatening. The suspect now facing many charges for assault and endangering the crowd that was protesting. In Atlanta, there were those who marched, saying that the justice system, in their opinion, failed again.
Still, they were determined to keep making their voices heard.
Right is right and wrong is wrong. At the end of the day, she lost her life and someone needs to be held accountable for it.
We've been marching for a while and we've been demanding change, and change has been slow. It's happened, but it's slow, and I think our elected officials just don't understand how resolute we are. This is a new movement, it's a new generation, and we won't give up.
Protesters marched from Woodruff Park to police headquarters, eventually ending up at the state capitol. The Georgia State Patrol says it used tear gas to break up the crowd after some protesters attempted to climb on a SWAT vehicle. About half the people scattered, but later 11 protesters were arrested after police warned them not to block the street. They're charged with failure to disperse. Under an executive order from Governor Brian Kemp extended just this week, the Georgia National Guard is still in place to protect public buildings in the city.
The Breonna Taylor case felt close to home for a Henry County family who says their grandfather was the victim of a no-knock warrant when officers raided the wrong home. Body camera video showing deputies were confused about which house they were heading to, but only fully realized the error after bursting into the wrong home and then handcuffing a 79-year-old grandfather who had heart trouble. Caitlin Ross spoke with his grandchildren today about why the Taylor decision is difficult for them to fathom.
Henry Norris's family says they're fighting for accountability in their own case. They're taking the deputies involved to appellate court after a lower court ruled those deputies had qualified immunity in their grandfather's case. They say they were heartbroken to learn the officers involved in Breonna Taylor's case would not be charged in her death.
Some devastating news to hear that those officers weren't going to be held responsible.
Henry Norris's granddaughter says it's hard not to take the grand jury decision in the Breonna Taylor case personally.
As a Black woman, it's like we're not valued as whole humans.
She sees a lot of similarities between what happened to her grandfather and what happened to Breonna Taylor. Both police entries stemmed from drug investigations. Breonna and Henry were both innocent, and neither one knew it was law enforcement who had entered their home.
My grandfather was in his home watching the news, and all of a sudden the police come in on him.
Henry's grandson says the same standard that's applied to everyday citizens should be applied to police.
If I break into your home, I'm gonna go to jail for breaking and entering, for trespassing. And if I kill someone, I'm gonna go to jail for murder.
They want to see jail time for the deputies who came into their grandfather's home. And they wanted jail time for the officers who came into Breonna Taylor's.
That's the only way it's gonna stop. That is the only way it's gonna stop. Until we start holding these officers accountable for their actions, it's going to continue to happen.
She says they're grateful their grandfather wasn't killed when Henry County deputies broke down their door. The department has declined to comment, so have attorneys representing the deputies involved.
While Taylor was killed by Louisville police, Atlanta protesters point to police shootings in our city that have remained unresolved. Cases like Kane Rogers, who was shot by Atlanta police officer James Burns in 2016, right near 11 Alive here, right outside of our studios. An internal investigation found no evidence that Rogers was involved in the reported break-ins that Burns was investigating when he simply opened fire on him. Burns was fired and charged with murder. This case still has not gone to trial, and it's 4 years down the road. And Detrick Griffin, who was killed by an Atlanta police officer in 2019 after the GBI, says he tried to steal an unmarked police car from a gas station. His family says that Griffin was unarmed, was shot as he was driving away from the officer. Their attorney says APD initially reached out about a settlement, then stopped responding. And DeAndre Phillips as well, who was
shot and killed as he sat in a car near the police annex building in 2017. Police initially said that officers were investigating the smell of marijuana coming from the car, and one of the officers was being dragged by Phillips' car when the officer shot him. But the family says surveillance video simply doesn't show that. The DA told us earlier this year that he wants to bring the case before a grand jury, but so far the officers have not been cleared or charged in connection with this case.
When we spoke with protesters, it's not just the Breonna Taylor case that's causing their frustration. It's the weight of all of these cases and so many others that aren't resolved. Here's how two women at Atlanta's demonstration last night described it in their own words.
Took me back to like my junior year self in high school where we got the verdict about the George Zimmerman case. So I cried a little, you know, but I understood that there's still work to be done. So that's why I'm here.
It definitely does hit different. I was extremely sad to see the verdict, considering especially how long it took to finally hear anything from the government up there. But it wasn't a surprise at all because that's how we've been treated repeatedly through history.
That protesting is just a tool in a toolbox of change as well as voting. So if you go and put them hand in hand, then it's you're going from the protest to the polls. Mm-hmm. So doing both of that's you being able to hit them in the street so that they're hearing your voice, but then also you're letting them know that my voice doesn't just matter when I'm in the streets, it matters on the ballot as well.
Training for police officers. I don't think 6 months is adequate to learn a position like that.
I think you just gotta see the facts and understand the facts that go with it and understand right is right, wrong is wrong, regardless of whether or not you agree with it.
Well, if you are feeling exhausted or numb today, you are certainly not alone. Therapist Adrian Slaughter says what you are experiencing is trauma going well beyond Breonna Taylor's case.
This is intergenerational. It has not stopped. We haven't had any time to preserve our mental health. We haven't had any space in history to address the intergenerational trauma that we deal with on a daily basis.
Slaughter says the trauma can manifest itself as exhaustion, insomnia, and depression. She urges people to seek help from a therapist who specifically understands culturally where you're coming from.
A rallying call in of all of this, that things need to change. 11 Alive's Joe Hanke spent the day talking to activists about measures they would like to see.
After months of protests and saying Breonna Taylor's name countless times, activists say on Wednesday they did not receive justice. Because Britt Jones-Chukera is an Atlanta-based activist who organizes local protests.
I was actually extremely shocked. I actually wanted to have hope.
We see very clearly that America is just incapable of giving Black people the justice that we deserve.
And Tamika Mallory is a national activist and co-founder of the organization Until Freedom. Both say the moment is now to push for noticeable changes towards racial equality and justice.
Congressman John Lewis, if he could go from not voting and Jim Crow laws to then, you know, seeing the first Black president, those are huge hills that he had to climb. And I just keep that same strength with me.
Jones-Chukera says changes begin with the police officers on the streets.
We need officers to get more involved with their communities so they can learn their communities and they can actually care about their communities.
In Washington, she says three bills currently in Congress could bring noticeable change: the Police Accountability Act, Grand Jury Reform Act, and Cooling Off Period Elimination Act. The bills would overhaul police departments and training, create systems for tracking use of force incidents, require the appointment of a special prosecutor in cases of law enforcement officers killing someone, and allow the DOJ to bring charges in such cases if states don't.
A ban on no-knock warrants is also included there.
Mallory says following Taylor's death, Louisville banned no-knock warrants, and she is supporting efforts now to do so across Kentucky and nationwide. She's also pushing for the defunding or redirecting of funds from police to other community needs.
Applying it to mental health, applying it to jobs in the community, making sure that people have proper housing and proper education. And that's what we want to see happen.
And both women tell me recent events have only increased the stakes for the upcoming November 3rd election. So that is why they're pushing for changes through laws, but are also saying everyone needs to register to vote and then make a plan for how they will early vote or vote on election day.
We have been asking all of you to text us your thoughts on this decision and the continued calls for change. You can let us know how you feel. Text us at the number on your screen. It's 404-885-7600. We'll have a look at some of your responses later on in the show.
The nation's top health experts weigh in on the race for a vaccine, what Dr. Anthony Fauci said about politics today in his chat with Emory doctors.
And as always, we are streaming right now on our 11 Alive YouTube channel. You can subscribe there. Join the conversation. That's another way for you to let us know how you're feeling and thinking. We've got more 11 Alive news in primetime after this break.
This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you.
Accused in a shooting spree in two separate counties now has been captured. The Clayton County Sheriff's Office took Carl Jordan into custody this morning. Clayton police say he's behind a triple shooting on Glen Court in the Hampton Lovejoy area last night, killing a mother, injuring a four-year-old, and also a grandmother who was trying to escape with that child. Police say he then ran out of bullets. He took off, but then he later shot another woman, this time in the head, at a Waffle House in McDonough early this morning, according to police. Jordan and the child's mother were in a relationship at some point, and then Jordan recently had been released from prison for a probation violation related to drug charges.
Dr. Anthony Fauci joined doctors from Emory University for a virtual roundtable to discuss COVID-19, building trust in the midst of misinformation, and the latest on vaccine developments. There was a heavy focus on the rush to find a vaccination. Dr. Sanjay Gupta asked Dr. Fauci to explain the vaccine approval process and if politics will come into play. This just 24 hours after the nation's top health officials testified on Capitol Hill, saying their decisions are guided by science and not politics. Fauci echoed those sentiments today, saying safety is the top priority. If the FDA recommends waiting before authorizing a vaccine, he'd agree it's best.
I rely very heavily on the decades of experience of the FDA scientists who say we should do this. And therefore, I would have to lean heavily on their side and support them.
Meanwhile, due to the stress of the pandemic and what it's placing on learning, Georgia school superintendent is revising how mandated tests are counted. He's lowering how Georgia milestones end of course scores are weighted. So it's now just 0.01% of the grade instead of the usual 20%. He says the move means the tests essentially won't count towards the grades at all, but it gets around a state law that says the weight can't be zero.
We are 11 Alive. Storm trackers have been tracking Beta now for days. It's post-tropical now, but it's bringing a lot of rain in across North Georgia. And there is a lot more to come as we head into the overnight hours as well. So right now it's near Tuscaloosa, Alabama, and it's likely to move right along this frontal boundary that's pulled up here. It's pretty much parallel to I-20. So that's just going to funnel it right across North Georgia in the overnight hours. And it's going to bring in some thunderstorms, I do think, especially here south of I-20, where we're seeing the thunderstorms in Alabama moving towards Randolph County. When I last measured the number of strikes, there were 10 strikes in this line. Now there's 7 as it approaches Randolph County line, and that's going to continue to move its way into West Georgia the next couple of hours. And ahead of it, a lot of moisture, so we're seeing the rain move in here on the south side. Most of it's been light to moderate within the last half hour or so, but there are some heavier downpours that will be moving in as we head into the late evening and the early morning, and that's going to give us a concern for maybe some locally flooded areas. Our threat for severe is pretty low. We haven't had any warnings in Alabama either, but the Storm Prediction Center giving Southern Alabama the best chance to see some severe weather tonight in terms of a marginal risk, an isolated risk here in the green. That's a level risk out of 5 levels. And then that risk shifts to our east as we head into tomorrow. So the Atlanta area, we're just expecting general showers and thunderstorms as we head through this evening, but there will be some gusty winds. You can see them right now in Rome. We have those winds gusting. You see the flag is flying and the streets are wet, and there's fog out there as well. So kind of treacherous driving conditions out there this evening. Temperatures didn't warm up much today. 68 was our high, 64 our low. So 4 degrees in terms of what we warmed up today. We should be around 80 degrees for a high temperature. So we were 12 degrees below average, and we picked up about a half an inch of rain thus far, with most likely more to come as we head into the overnight hours. So during the overnight, we expect those rain chances to go up as that line approaches, the one that's associated with post-tropical depression beta, and that's going to bring in a few thunderstorms early on as well. So that may awaken you early in the day, and that morning commute, well, there'll be some showers around as well, so you may need to leave a little extra time to get to where you need to go. And then throughout the day tomorrow, we'll see things start to shape up around lunchtime, some breaks in the clouds, a few peaks of sunshine, and then possibly an isolated shower or storm as we head into the afternoon and evening hours. I think for the most of our Friday night football games are probably going to be okay, but we'll watch the radar for you because there will be some spots where we do see some action. So this evening we have the rain all across North Georgia. In comes that line. That's what was associated with beta. That moves in as we head in towards the midnight hour. So through Rome, Carrollton, into Heard County as we get towards midnight, and then it sweeps across the Atlanta area overnight, leaving behind just a few showers for the morning commute tomorrow and a lot of widespread dense fog throughout the morning. And then as we get into the afternoon, still some wraparound moisture here, maybe an isolated thunderstorm or two as we head into Friday night, and then we'll wake up on Saturday morning to a mostly dry weekend. There'll still be a few little sprinkles around and widespread fog Saturday morning, and then it should start to shape up. So rainy through tonight, winds gusty at times, gusting up to around 25, even 28 miles per hour, and some dense areas of fog just to watch out for on the roadways, not just tonight, but also tomorrow night. So on your Friday, a 5 on the wasometer on the scale of 1 to 11, with 11 being a perfect day, we have a 50% chance of precip overall, although it'll be lessening later on in the day. And then as we head into Monday, we'll end up seeing Saturday, we end up seeing some dense morning fog. And then the weekend looks mostly dry, a 30% chance on our Monday, 20% chance on Tuesday, and warm over the weekend with much cooler temperatures once we get to the middle of next week.
More frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
Thank you.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're...
President Trump says he will announce his Supreme Court appointment on Saturday to replace the late Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Joining me now is national columnist Ron Hart. Ron, the Supreme Court, by definition, is not supposed to be political, but it's folly to believe that that is the case. How does this all play out? And shouldn't both parties be ashamed of how they have treated the court over the last couple of years?
I think you're right, Jeff. I think I wouldn't be surprised if the San Francisco Ninth District Court of Appeals overturns her death. And said she didn't die. So I don't think the Democrats have the high moral ground here. Neither do the Republicans. It's pure political power. And in this case, the Republicans control the Senate, and they can get whoever they want in there, especially with Mitt Romney on board right now.
A few of my Democratic friends say that Ruth Bader Ginsburg on her deathbed said she didn't want her seat to be filled until after the election. My Republican friends say that's an outright lie. She never said any of that. So, I mean, that's another example of all of this.
Yeah, the Constitution is not a wish list. The Constitution is pretty firm in what it says it can do. The president appoints and the Senate advises and consents to it. So it's a pretty easy process. It'll probably get done between now and year end. It'll be a woman, I'm pretty sure. Trump's been interviewing a lot of women. Trump's a little bit different in his vetting process. This Trump has a swimsuit competition in his vetting process. Unique to other presidents.
I'm sorry I'm laughing at that. We know you love award shows. The Emmy Awards, Country Music Award shows went on virtually. Is that a sign that perhaps the apocalypse is upon us?
Well, with COVID and everything and civil unrest and racial strife, you got recessions, you got COVID. It's good to see the celebrities take time to honor themselves. But on Taylor Swift, I mean, the main thing about her is I like her shorter songs because they're over center. So she's kind of made the crossover between both genres, and she's back to country music right now. I'm just afraid someday that you and I will end up in one of her songs, and that would not be good for you, though.
See, unlike you, I'm out of the demo when it comes to Taylor Swift. I have really no clue about her other than I know she has lived in Nashville. That's about it.
Yeah.
Okay, we move on. NASA is laying out a $28 billion plan to submit to Congress that will return astronauts to the moon. President Trump's serious about putting a woman on the moon. Would you like to go to the moon as well, Ron? Go ahead. I'll toss these 16-inch softballs at you.
I barely fly Delta now. I'm a little scared of Delta, the TSA and everything. No, I think the woman he puts on the moon, my guess, it'll probably be Nancy Pelosi. It'll be the first one he sends up there. You know, I'm not into that, you know, the moon. I think we're wasting a lot of money up there. There's a lot to do here. $28 billion is a lot. I mean, the space program so far, we've gotten Velcro and Tang. So I'm not sure really it pays off. Elon Musk, the private sector, has been exploring space. Let the private sector do it. I mean, I'm not a big fan of that. I know it's big for Florida. A lot of people like the space program, but it's been a long time. You know, 1969, you know, men walked on the moon, and here it is 2020, and men are walking on eggshells.
And that's no yoke.
No.
Very nice. And by the way, I got your Tang reference, but the Taylor Swift sort of went over my head.
Yeah, she's, yeah.
Part of the demo, part of the demographic, as we say in the broadcast business. Ron Hart, thank you.
Get some of the younger people around the studio to explain to you.
All right, Ron, thank you and good night.
Good to see you.
Televised newscast, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
Thank you.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
An attorney for Breonna Taylor's family says they were outraged and insulted by a grand jury's decision not to charge any Louisville police officers directly with the death of Breonna Taylor, the 26-year-old EMT who was shot and killed inside her apartment. Today, the family's attorney called the proceedings a sham and pointed a finger at the Kentucky Attorney General.
When you think about, they had wanton endangerment for the white neighbor's apartment, the bullets going there, but not for the bullets going into Breonna Taylor's body. It underscores what I've said many times. We seem to have two justice systems in America, one for black America and one for white America.
Attorney Chris Stewart is familiar with several high-profile cases similar to Breonna Taylor. He represents the family of Ahmaud Arbery, George Floyd, and Rayshard Brooks. Today, he sat down with Morning Rush anchor Sheba Russell to give some perspective on Taylor's case.
We heard from the attorney general yesterday talking about how the charges of manslaughter and reckless homicide was brought before this grand jury. People are having a hard time wrapping their heads around what actually happens in these secret proceedings here. Are the attorneys representing the Taylor family right to say that there's some sort of cover-up that was happening here in the proceedings in which the evidence was presented to the grand jury?
You know, I think from watching everything yesterday and watching the Attorney General's press conference, it's just clear that Attorney General Cameron had already made his mind up about what he wanted to happen before he took it to the grand jury. To get up there and say he still doesn't know if one of Hankins's bullets actually hit her. He didn't address the other officers that were on the scene and if there's body camera footage. To rely on one witness who changed his mind after three interviews and said that they did announce themselves, but there's 10 that said they didn't. It makes no sense. I mean, it shows where he was trying to go. A grand jury can only do what you give them. So that's the horrific part.
A two-day grand jury proceeding, unusual or the norm?
Well, it depends on how much evidence is going to be given to them. You know, right now with COVID, times are shorter, longer. You know, there's nothing odd about that, but it's just odd from his presentation about what he still doesn't know, but yet took it to a grand jury. And immediately had already in his mind cleared the officers for use of force.
Do you find this wanton endangerment charge to be odd?
Well, I find it odd that no one to this day has been charged in Breonna Taylor's murder. The neighbors received more justice than she did, even though 32 shots were fired, none hit her boyfriend who had the weapon, and six hit her.
And none hit the neighbors as well. What are the next steps here, Elchris Stewart?
They just have to see if the federal government is going to do anything. They can still bring charges. Mr. Cameron has already made it clear that he's done. And I know a lot of people are upset because they're saying that he did this to fulfill promises to the police department. And we just don't know. We have to wait for the federal government, but it just truly shows the power of the prosecutor and if they've already made up their mind on what they're going to do.
We're running out of time here, but before we go, if you were representing Taylor's family, what would you tell them this morning?
Just stay strong. Keep the faith, and we mourn the loss of their daughter.
All right. Attorney Elchris Stewart, managing partner with Stewart Miller Simmons Trial Attorneys. We thank you for your time.
We have this full interview and much more posted right now on the 11 Alive YouTube page, including extended interviews with people who tell us why they decided to protest last night in Metro Atlanta.
Well, your 11 Alive storm trackers continue to watch post-tropical depression Beta that is moving across northern Alabama right now. Notice how it's changed our atmosphere. Where the blue was, it was dry and it was cool. Now that blue air is moving out and the moist air is taking its place along with that post-tropical depression that's moving through northern Alabama and heading in our general direction as we head into the overnight hours. So you can see the line that's associated with it in Alabama. It's been producing some lightning within the last 30 minutes or so. And in advance of it, we have widespread moisture moving in. So the atmosphere is moistening up. And then we're going to have that lifting mechanism of that low pressure moving in. And that's going to cause some showers and some thunderstorms as we head into the late evening and the early morning hours. And ahead of it, if you're out and about yet this evening, grab your umbrella. You're going to need it. There's showers widespread all across North Georgia, over into Northwest Georgia and Rome, where we're seeing some pockets of heavier rain. But I think the heaviest stuff is still in Alabama, and that's going to be coming in the next few hours. So here's the timing of that. We have the showers out ahead. We have the line in Alabama that's going to be pushing in our direction. So right around 10, 11 o'clock, it should be moving through Randolph and Cleburne County, and then by around midnight into West Georgia. So from Heard County into Carroll County on up into Floyd County, we'll have some heavy rain, and we'll likely hear some rumbles of thunder, gusty winds up around 25 miles per hour or so overnight. So some waterlogged soil may end up bringing down some trees in some spots and some tree limbs. And then throughout the day tomorrow, we'll end up seeing the very foggy conditions to start, and then more scattered showers throughout the day. So the heaviest rain expected here across far north Georgia, where we could end up seeing some 3-4 inches in some of the most waterlogged areas. So coming up, we'll talk about what we can expect for the rest of this week and as we head into the weekend.
Samantha, thank you. At 12, most kids are obsessing over the internet or social media. Many of them are, at least for the parents that allow it. But a Marietta boy is now focused on finishing college. He is a marvel. He's already a sophomore, only 12. Latasha Givens with a look at a young man who has been defying expectations every step, every baby step along the way.
Caleb.
This.
This is Caleb Anderson learning sight words. But before he could verbally communicate, he learned sign language.
And by 9 months old, he was able to sign over 250 words. And by 11 months old, he was speaking and reading.
And this is Caleb at 2, reading the United States Constitution.
Of the United States.
Claire and Kobe Anderson say they soon realized their first child was special.
As we started to interact with other parents, and you know, had other children, then we started to realize how exceptional this experience was, because we had no other frame of reference.
By age 3, Caleb qualified for Mensa. When he joined at 5, his family says they were told he was the youngest African-American boy to be accepted at the time. Caleb whizzed through elementary, middle, and high school.
And he said, Mom, I'm bored. this is not challenging. It's really not helping me grow in my learning. It's like, I think I'm ready to go to college.
Now he's 12 years old and just started his sophomore year at Chattahoochee Technical College.
What was it like being a freshman in college at your age?
It was exactly how I expected it to be if I was like 18 or something.
Because of his age, Dad has to chaperone him on campus.
So you've had to go back to college basically with him?
Yes. Yeah, go back to college, you know.
But he is not Caleb's study buddy.
He's actually far surpassed me in math, so I can't help him anymore. I mean, seriously, he's in calculus too now.
The Andersons have two other children, Aaron and Hannah, who are also gifted. While Caleb is outscoring his college classmates, his mother says there are more exceptionally gifted children like Caleb than we may think.
I think people have a negative perspective, a negative thinking when it comes to African-American boys. And I felt as that there are many of other Calebs out there, but they don't have the opportunity or the resources.
Latasha Givens reporting for us. For many registering to vote, it takes seconds. For some, it's a goal that took years, sometimes decades, to achieve. Why one woman isn't taking a registration for granted.
Some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear, on 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
President Trump traveled to the Supreme Court today to honor the late Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, as lawmakers in both parties are reacting to his refusal to commit to a peaceful transfer of power if he loses the election. Here's Alice Barr of NBC with the very latest from Washington.
Paying his respects to the late Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg today, President Trump was greeted by chants of vote him out. amid growing outrage over his insistence on filling her seat before the election. Adding to the controversy today, the president's refusal to commit to a peaceful transfer of power if he loses the election. President Trump again claiming without evidence that a surge in mail-in ballots will lead to widespread fraud.
Will you commit to making sure that there is a peaceful transfer of power after the election?
Well, we're going to have to see what happens. You know that I've been complaining very strongly about the ballots, and the ballots are a disaster.
I understand that, but people are rioting. Do you commit to making sure that there's a peaceful transfer of power?
We want to get rid of the ballots, and you'll have a very peaceful. There won't be a transfer, frankly. There'll be a continuation.
Furious reaction from Democrats.
Get rid of the ballots. Just let him stay in power for whatever illicit way he chooses to do so. That's what he's saying.
Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell leading a string of prominent Republicans pushing back against the president's words, insisting there will be an orderly transition. President Trump also acknowledging he wants to fill Justice Ginsburg's open seat before the election, which would cement a conservative majority, because he expects the election results to be challenged in the Supreme Court.
Well, the rain is moving in tonight. Widespread showers with some heavier downpours, especially over the Alabama line that's heading in our general direction right now. These associated with what was Tropical Storm Beta. Now it's post-tropical, only has winds up around 25 miles per hour. But some of those gusty winds will be moving in as that area of low pressure works right along this frontal boundary here, this warm front. And we're seeing a good fetch of moisture coming in off the Gulf of Mexico ahead of that front. So this basically means we're going to have a kind of a soggy evening. It's going to be foggy overnight, and we'll see some isolated heavy downpours with some possible lightning and thunder resulting from that as well. So we're seeing those showers right now popping up all across North Georgia, and that line on approach starting to move into Cleburne County and Randolph County right now with a little bit of lightning, five strikes in the last 15 minutes, not a tremendous amount at this point, but just enough where we do have a threat to see a few thunderstorms as we head through the overnight hours. And we're going to continue to see that as we head in to the overnight and morning commute as well. So into Dalton we go, Calhoun, seeing some heavier downpours there. And then here in the Athens area, they had some rain move through earlier, but they're in a bit of a break right now as we take a look at how things are looking right now in the classic city of Athens. Not too shabby at all. Just the streets are a little wet, but we're not seeing any active heavy rain or anything like that at the moment. But plenty of moisture left over as temperatures start to cool, to see some very dense fog in Athens as well as across the rest of North Georgia as we head out the door tomorrow. So here are low temperatures from this morning. Not nearly as cool as we were earlier in the week when we were down around 50 degrees. So 64 was our low this morning, 61 in Canton, 60 in Carrollton. Our highs today were not much warmer than that. We didn't warm up much with the widespread cloud cover. 68 in Covington, 73 in Athens. They had a few more breaks of sunshine. 66 in Canton, though, and 65 in Gainesville. So we really just didn't warm up with all that thick, dense cloud cover. And as we head into the overnight hours, we're going to continue to see those rain chances going up as that line moves in. So that means we could see some thunderstorms overnight, or hear the thunderstorms. Most of us will be in bed. And then we'll end up seeing things continue to stay rather showery as we head into the first part of tomorrow. So expect to see those rain chances for the morning commute, then some breaks in the action, and we'll likely see some isolated showers or storms in the afternoon. But I think the main show is going to be overnight and into the morning commute tomorrow, and then things should start to slowly quiet down. It's just going to be a little slow to clear because we have an area of low pressure behind Beta as well. And that's just going to keep us kind of socked in throughout much of the day tomorrow. So in comes the line. This is around 11:30. That's when things start to come down heavier across West Georgia, in through Marietta, and then in through Atlanta as we head into the early morning hours. And once we get into tomorrow during the day, just seeing some of that wraparound moisture here, just a few isolated scattered showers as we head through the afternoon and evening. And then Saturday morning, we should be mostly dry, but there'll be a few sprinkles left the first half of the the day, as well as some very dense fog. So rainfall amounts will be heaviest across far north Georgia, where we could end up seeing almost 2 inches of rain in some spots. Here across the Atlanta area, we're expecting to see around a half an inch to an inch. And there are those gusty winds we'll likely see during the overnight hour. So just if you're out early in the morning before dark, there may be some branches down in the roadway. So just drive with care, especially with the foggy conditions. So tomorrow, a 5 on the wasometer. We have a 60% chance of rain in the morning, and then it tapers off throughout the day. We'll have more fog on Saturday, a few sprinkles to start, and then we'll see some sunshine by the afternoon. So mostly dry weekend, just a 20% chance on Sunday, 30% chance on Monday. And then notice how those temperatures that are warm over the weekend start coming down. We should see temperatures in the low 70s by the time we get to Thursday with cool, crisp, sunny conditions.
Agencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear, on 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear, on 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray.
For many of us here in Georgia, it takes just minutes to register to vote. We can do it online, even from the comfort of our homes. But for others, casting a ballot is a process decades in the making. Melalane Rose Davies became a citizen this week in Gwinnett County. She came to America from Liberia when she was just 2 years old, and since then has tried 5 times to pass the citizenship test. At one point, she faced deportation and homelessness, but she told Haran Jones there was one moment that made the struggle all worthwhile.
Now you are a U.S. citizen. So what does that mean to you, and what's a priority for you?
I just want to say, this means this. The first thing I received today was my registration to vote. When I sat down, I looked at the paper, I was like, yes, yes, yes. So that means so much to me because, you know, at this, time in our society, everyone wants to have a voice.
The numbers show more and more people in Georgia, just like Davies, are looking to make their voices heard at the ballot box. Voter registration in Georgia is up 9% from December of 2018, with more than 7 million voters eligible to cast their ballots this November. The numbers are growing, particularly in minority populations, with a 21% increase among Hispanic voters, 18% for Asians and Pacific Islanders, and 16% for Native Americans or Alaskan Natives. There's also an increase in Black voters, up to 8% since 2018. So here's some extra important dates that you want to keep on your mind if you're heading out to the polls and you want to be included before or on Election Day. October 5th is the last day that you can register to vote in the November election. A week later, early in-person voting begins. If you want to vote absentee, you have to request a ballot by October 30th, and then Tuesday, November 3rd is Election Day. 11 Live is doing everything we can to make sure your vote is secure. So for a list of important dates and more election resources, you can head to 11alive.com/vote. You can also find the information you need inside our 11 Alive app. Ahead in Primetime, calls for changes after no officers were directly charged with killing Breonna Taylor. So what would that change look like? The specific measures activists are supporting on the local and national levels.
We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside?
If you are planning a trip this fall, Google Maps wants to help you check the spread of coronavirus in states, counties, and some cities. If you click on the layer, it will show you a color-coded map with the 7-day average of confirmed cases. A label indicates if the rate is going up or down. The new feature rolls out on Android and iOS this week. Georgia's latest COVID-19 numbers show that things are fairly stable. New cases are slightly down from yesterday, around 1,360. There are also 49 additional deaths today, right at our 14-day average. We had hoped this number would fall more by now, but on the upside, we're still not seeing the anticipated post-Labor Day spike.
The number of new COVID patients may be falling, but the number of people heading to the hospital to be treated for the virus has remained steady, about 1,400 a day right now. And that has frontline workers like Wilbur Kennedy exhausted, not only with the work, but with the sacrifices his family is making.
We're right in their face doing the intubations on the ventilator.
Despite the risk, Kennedy says his wife and three boys wanted to stick together, even if it meant staying apart from others.
My boys can't go and see their grandmother, and also my neighbor. We had to sever that relationship. I used to take my scrubs off at home in the garage. Now there's the change of clothes and this whole scrubbing out all the way to the shoes. The question is always, am I taking this to my family?
Tonight on Up Late, what the CDC now knows about the virus's impact on healthcare workers and what Kennedy says is helping them get through it all.
Right now on Primetime, with so much riding on the November election, a Georgia man shares his cautionary tale why you should check your voter registration status right now.
It wasn't a surprise at all because that's how we've been treated repeatedly through history.
In their own words, black women on the front lines of the push for change, how they see their role in shaping America's future.
11 Alive News Primetime on the ATL starts now.
First tonight, the rain is getting heavier and storms are possible in some areas out there. Let's get you straight to meteorologist Samantha Moore and the Storm Tracker Center with what to expect the rest of the night, Sam.
Yeah, Aisha, I think we'll see some heavy downpours the next few hours, particularly as we approach midnight and into the early morning, as what's left of Beta, now post-tropical, is working its way through northern Alabama in our general direction. And there is a line of thunderstorms associated with that area of low pressure. So there is what's left of Beta moving to the east and right along this frontal boundary here. So that's going to put it across North Georgia in the next few hours, and you can see how that line of thunderstorms continues to strengthen a bit, stretching from about east of Gadsden down through Lineville and then into Alexander City in Alabama. So moving into Cleburne and Randolph counties right now, and then we'll shortly, within the next hour and a half, start moving into West Georgia. So we've seen our share of showers ahead of this tonight, but I think the heaviest rain is going to be associated with that main line, and right now in Lineville we have that line moving through with strikes of lightning counting up to around 7 right now. So there won't be a tremendous amount of lightning with this line as it moves through, but we could hear those rumbles of thunder, see some of those flashes of lightning, and experience some heavy rain as it moves in as well. We've already seen some heavy downpours yet tonight, or already tonight, and they're continuing across North Georgia right now. And we're seeing some breaks in the action, like in Athens, but more rain will be moving in as we head into the overnight. In fact, we'll see that line crossing over, as we said, late in the evening or into the early morning hours here, and then traversing across North Georgia as we head into the middle of the night. So you may wake in to the sound of thunder as we headed to those early morning hours. And coming up, how long the rain is going to hang around on Friday and what that will mean for our weekend.
Right now, people are once again gathering in downtown Louisville, Kentucky, as they have for the last 6 months, demanding justice for Breonna Taylor. Police shot and killed a 26-year-old in March while executing a botched drug raid. Well, yesterday a grand jury announced no officer will be directly charged in her death. The announcement touched off angry clashes between protesters and law enforcement overnight. And Aisha, as you know, activists around the country say the justice system has failed them.
That, Ron, that decision is also bringing people in Atlanta to the streets for a mostly peaceful protest.
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
If we don't get it,
shut it down!
If we don't get it,
shut it down!
The march is slightly marred by a few moments of chaos leading to 11 arrests. They come just days after Governor Kemp signed an executive order extending the state of emergency using the National Guard to protect public buildings. Today, voting rights advocate Stacey Abrams addressed the ongoing impact of Breonna Taylor's death.
Her loss remains immeasurable, but more importantly, the lack of access to justice remains deeply disturbing. We live in a nation of laws and a nation that works best when everyone is held accountable.
Today, activists tell our Joe Henke they are determined to keep pushing for changes in Taylor's name.
need officers who can de-escalate. We need officers who actually learn their communities instead of just coming to their communities and already having a bias.
Britt Jones Chukura is an Atlanta-based activist who over the summer organized and was present at many protests across Atlanta. With Breonna Taylor's name in mind, she says she hopes three bills currently in Congress aimed at police reform can institute change. The Police Accountability Act, Grand Jury Reform Act, and Cooling Off Period Elimination Act. The bills would overhaul police departments and training, create systems for tracking use of force incidents, require the appointment of a special prosecutor in cases of law enforcement officers killing someone, and allow the DOJ to bring charges in such cases if states do not. Another change Jones Chukura wants to see is for people who support the push for racial equality and social justice reform but have not spoken up to find their voice.
Since your silence towards support for our lives is loud enough, and it creates an
County family says that they were devastated to hear the news that the officers involved in the Breonna Taylor case would not be charged in her death. They say her case is all too similar to their grandfather's, where deputies raided the wrong home in 2018. They told our Caitlin Ross they want to see more accountability for law enforcement.
Henry Norris has owned the same home for 50 years. The 79-year-old is retired and was watching the news when he saw a flashbang go off inside his home in 2018. On helmet camera footage obtained by 11 Alive, you can see the confusion on his face as deputies handcuff him as part of a drug investigation. But deputies were at the wrong house. They were supposed to serve the warrant at the home next door, a mistake his grandkids think they should be held accountable for.
It can happen to anyone. My grandfather was in his home watching the news, and all of a sudden the police come in on him.
His granddaughter says she can't imagine how Breonna Taylor must have felt.
If you cannot feel, you know, safe at home, you know, where are we supposed to be safe at?
She says she was heartbroken to hear the officers in the Breonna Taylor case would not be charged in her death. She thinks everyone should be outraged.
Everyone needs to speak out because it can happen to anyone. And luckily, in my grandfather's case, he wasn't killed.
A lower court ruled the deputies had qualified immunity when they entered Norris's home. The family is now taking them to appellate court to try and reverse that decision. The Henry County Sheriff's Department and those deputies have declined to comment.
Georgians have a lot to say about the Breonna Taylor case and the demands for justice for black men and women everywhere. 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks, and we are listening. Some of you say the grand jury got it right, like this viewer who writes, personally, I believe the officers announced their position as law enforcement officers. They always do. And yes, I am African American. Others are expressing their hurt and frustration. Another viewer asking, how would you expect a homeowner to react if you heard what may have been burglars trying to break into your home? What is it about our black skin that causes such fear among certain people? My heart bleeds in tears of frustration, wondering, when will we as black people be recognized as people? We are just as important as anyone.
You know, this case is deeply personal for so many people out there, especially for black women. It touches on deeply rooted issues like equality, security, and injustice. Here are just some of the stories shared with us during last night.
Junior year self in high school, where we got the verdict about the George Zimmerman case, so I cried a little, you know, but I understood that there's still work to be done, so that's why I'm here.
Extremely disappointed considering all the work we've done, but that just means we have way more work to keep doing, and that's why we're out here.
No justice!
No peace!
No justice!
No peace!
So I think protest to the polls. Being able to hit them in the streets so that they're hearing your voice, but then also you're letting them know that my voice doesn't just matter when I'm in the streets, it matters on the ballot as well.
Training for police officers. I don't think 6 months
alone. Therapist Adrian Slaughter says what you're experiencing is trauma going well beyond the Breonna Taylor case.
This is intergenerational. It has not stopped. We haven't had any time to preserve our mental health. We haven't had any space in history to address the intergenerational trauma that we deal with on a daily basis.
She says trauma can manifest itself as exhaustion, insomnia, and depression. She urges people to seek help from a therapist who specifically understands culturally where you're coming from. We will continue bringing you the latest developments in the Breonna Taylor case and efforts to create change here in Georgia. Just tap on the 11 Alive app.
New tonight on Primetime, some high school parents in Jackson County are really upset over what they're calling racist comments from a football announcer at a game. As Chenu Her explains, they went straight to the school district for answers.
It was at this football game in Jefferson, parents of students at Jackson County Comprehensive High School say the game announcer caught them off guard. They say he asked fans to wear masks to prevent the spread of the Chinese virus in reference to COVID-19.
I saw families that I knew that were Asian just literally hold their heads down and just look toward the ground, and I knew exactly what they were thinking.
Susan Martin says while some parents laughed, she didn't find it funny at all, so she sent a complaint to the superintendent.
It's not okay for an announcement like that to be made over the loudspeaker.
One of those parents Martin talked to says her son is on the football team. She didn't want to be identified, but sent this text message to 11 Alive saying, I couldn't help but feel like there was a target on my back. For what? Because I'm Asian, my son and daughter are Asian. Like I'm to blame for the virus? This behavior just condones hate crimes like it's okay. Jackson County Schools Superintendent Dr. April Howard told 11 Alive the district and school have addressed the situation with the volunteer announcer and added, Jackson County Comprehensive High School prides itself on providing a very inclusive environment. The unfortunate use of that term in no way represents the feeling or climate of the school or school district.
I don't believe that everybody at Jackson County feels that way. I believe it was an off-the-cuff remark that does not represent our school.
And you know, this helps to put it into perspective. According to the U.S. Census, Jackson County's population is only 2% Asian. Martin wants all families to feel accepted. All right, straight ahead, the nation's top health experts weigh in on the race for a vaccine, what Dr. Anthony Fauci said about politics today in his chat with Emory Doctors.
And don't forget, we are streaming right now on the 11 Alive YouTube channel. Subscribe and join the conversation in the community section. We've got more 11 Alive News in Primetime after the break.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscast, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff,
There are a lot of potential pitfalls for voters this year, and some you may never consider. Fulton County is now adding 91 polling places in November. That means you might expect to vote in one place when you're actually assigned to another. Or perhaps you think your voter registration is up to date, but the state thinks you're dead. 11 Alive's Doug Richards found that's exactly what happened to one man.
When Bill Clinton ran for re-election 24 years ago, Terrell Johnson cast his first ever vote as a young man in Augusta.
Been voting in Georgia basically all my life.
Johnson says he voted in Fulton County in the June primary and the August runoff. Applying for a November absentee ballot, he says he checked his registration online a few weeks ago.
and shown me as active, which of course I was.
But then he says he checked the Secretary of State's website again this week, and he says his registration was gone.
But they had me as being dead.
You don't appear to be dead.
Alive and well.
Johnson had gone to the Georgia Secretary of State's website at sos.ga.gov, clicked on elections, then you click on Where Do I Vote MVP, which stands for My Voter Page. A form comes up. Enter your name and date of birth. And it told me that I'm voting at an elementary school that's different than the place I've voted at for most of the last 20 years. It also tells me that the absentee ballot I requested in August was issued a week ago, though I still haven't seen it. You can find a link to all of this on 11alive.com.
Somebody must have been very close to my name, or almost exactly my name, had passed away. Yeah. And so they confused our voter registration records.
Johnson says it's easy to check your voter status online and that Fulton County is fixing his.
They were very helpful.
Does it shake your confidence any?
It shakes my confidence a little bit that those kinds of errors, like I say, could have happened to lots of other people and they would never know it until they showed up on election day.
And Johnson says he expects to vote absentee and says he'll keep checking until the site shows that the county has received his ballot.
And as Doug pointed out, you can find everything you need to ensure your vote is counted on 11alive.com/vote. We have important election dates, links to check your voter status, and a lot more. You'll also find information on our 11 Alive app.
We're watching what is left of our tropical storm Beta, now post-tropical, moving through northern Alabama right now and bringing in a line of heavier downpours here in eastern Alabama. And that area of low pressure is going to be working its way right across this trough of low pressure, which is in the form of a warm front here, aligning with I-20. So that's going to be the focus of the energy as we head into the next several hours during the early morning hours. I think that's where we could see some of the stormiest conditions, particularly here from around the warm front southward. And we have a good fetch of moisture coming off the Gulf of Mexico, so that'll fuel some of these showers and storms. So most of our showers ahead of that line now have become a little bit more fine. They're not as heavy at this point in most areas. They're on the light side. But the line that's moving in towards Randolph and Cleburne counties in Alabama right now, that is going to bring in some pretty good rain. No lightning at the moment. There was some lightning associated with that line, but that is diminished. So as we head into the late evening and early morning, we expect to see that rain on the increase. You can see right now we have showers in Roswell stretching on up towards Lake Lanier. Also, and from Rome into Calhoun and into Dalton, we have some decent showery activity, but I don't think it's going to be all that heavy until we get to those overnight hours. So we do have the best chance of seeing some isolated severe storms here across southeastern Alabama, including Randolph County. They have a chance for some isolated severe storms as that line we were just looking at moves on through, I think, in the next couple of hours. And then tomorrow, that focus of severe, that isolated severe, will be to our southeast as we head in through the afternoon and evening hours. And we'll have a chance for some showers and some general thunderstorms in this particular instance. Looking out over Rome, look at those winds picking up right now. Yes, the winds are going to increase as that line approaches into Rome. And you can see the rain is coming down right now as well. Earlier today, one of our 11 Alive storm trackers, Jamie, posted this picture of a morning rainbow in the clouds and a little bit of showery activity as the sun came up. So very nice start to the day to have a rainbow to start you off. We looked at temperatures today that were on the cool side. In fact, we just didn't warm up that much at all. We were at 68 for a high, 64 for a low. We should be around 80. So we were 12 degrees below average for our high temperature. And we picked up now almost an inch of rain at the airport out of this event. And we still have that good line to move in. So we'll probably end up with over an inch out of this event this evening and into the early morning hours. So as we get into the nighttime hours, we'll continue to see those rain chances throughout the night. Mostly it'll be showers, but there may be an isolated thunderstorm or two. It looks like we could see our heaviest rain in the early morning with that line we were just looking at on the radar between around 1 and 3 a.m. And those winds will be the strongest at that time too. And then throughout tomorrow, we'll start out with a chance for some showers for that morning commute, lots of dense fog, and then we'll see some breaks in the action throughout the day. Isolated showers possible, isolated thunderstorms. But I think for the most part, for our Friday night football, we should be starting to taper off at that time in terms of rainfall. So as far as tonight goes, we have the showers in advance of the big line that's moving through. That line that's going to be moving in at a pretty decent pace. It's moving to the east at around 15 miles per hour or so. That should put it roaming into Carrollton and into Heard County just after midnight, and then pushing a little bit further into Marietta and into Austell right around 3 in the morning. And then as we head in towards daybreak, we'll have those showers around still with some heavier stuff off to the east. So expect to see the foggy conditions with low clouds in the morning, quite a few showers around for the morning. And then as we head in towards the evening, just a few isolated showers to contend with for Friday night football. So I think we'll end up being mostly dry for the night. And then Saturday morning, still a few little sprinkles possibly, and a lot of stubborn low clouds. That's going to take a while to clear. They're not going to clear out quite as quickly as we would like. So the heaviest rain will be across far north Georgia as we head into the next 48 hours and off to our northeast. We're expecting to see right around a half an inch to another inch as we head into tomorrow. So here's a look at your 7-day forecast. Foggy start to our Friday and our Saturday. We have about a 60% chance of rain to start tomorrow, tapering off throughout the day. And then I think Saturday is going to be mostly dry, maybe a few sprinkles to start. And then by the afternoon, it'll be slowly clearing out. Sunday, another front approaches. That gives us a 20% chance of rain, 30% chance as the front moves in on Monday. And then behind that front, what do we have? Some nice crisp fall sunshine to look forward to on our Wednesday and Thursday.
Dr. Anthony Fauci joined doctors from Emory University for a virtual roundtable to talk about COVID-19, building trust in the midst of misinformation, and the latest on vaccine developments. There was a heavy focus on the rush to find a vaccine. Dr. Sanjay Gupta asked Dr. Fauci to explain the vaccine approval process and if politics will come into play. This just 24 hours after the nation's top health officials testified on Capitol Hill, saying their decisions are guided by science and not politics. Fauci echoed those sentiments today, saying safety is the top priority. If the FDA recommends waiting before authorizing a vaccine, he'd agree it's best.
I rely very heavily on the decades of experience of the FDA scientists who say we should do this. And therefore, I would have to lean heavily on their side and support them.
Due to the stress the pandemic is placing on learning, Georgia's school superintendent is revising how mandated tests are counted. He's lowering how Georgia milestones end of course scores are weighted. So it's now just 0.01% of the grade instead of the usual 20%. He says the move means the test essentially won't count towards the grade at all, but gets around a state law that says the weight cannot be zero.
This is COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscast, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
President Trump says he will announce his Supreme Court appointment on Saturday to replace the late Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Joining me now is national columnist Ron Hart. Ron, the Supreme Court, by definition, is not supposed to be political, but it's folly to believe that that is the case. How does this all play out? And shouldn't both parties be ashamed of how they have treated the court over the last couple of years?
I think you're right, Jeff. I think I wouldn't be surprised if the San Francisco Ninth District Court of Appeals overturns her death. And say she didn't die. So I don't think the Democrats have the high moral ground here. Neither do the Republicans. It's pure political power. And in this case, the Republicans control the Senate, and they can get whoever they want in there, especially with Mitt Romney on board right now.
A few of my Democratic friends say that Ruth Bader Ginsburg on her deathbed said she didn't want her seat to be filled until after the election. My Republican friends say that's an outright lie. She never said any of that. So, I mean, that's another example of all of this.
Yeah, the Constitution is not a wish list. The Constitution is pretty firm in what it says it can do. The president appoints and the Senate advises and consents to it. So it's a pretty easy process. It'll probably get done through now and year end. It'll be a woman, I'm pretty sure. Trump's been interviewing a lot of women. Trump's a little bit different in his vetting process. Trump has a swimsuit competition in his vetting process, unique to other presidents.
I'm sorry I'm laughing at that. We know you love award shows. The Emmy Awards, Country Music Award shows went on virtually. Is that a sign that perhaps the apocalypse is upon us?
Well, with COVID and everything and civil unrest and racial strife, you got recessions, you got COVID. It's good to see the celebrities take time to honor themselves. But on Taylor Swift, I mean, the main thing about her is I like her shorter songs because they're over center. So she's kind of made the crossover between both genres, and she's back to country music right now. I'm just afraid someday that you and I will end up in one of her songs. That would not be good for you, though.
See, unlike you, I'm out of the demo when it comes to Taylor Swift. I have really no clue about her other than I know she has lived in Nashville. That's about it.
Yeah.
Okay, we move on. NASA is laying out a $28 billion plan to submit to Congress that will return astronauts to the moon. President Trump's serious about putting a woman on the moon. Would you like to go to the moon as well, Ron? Go ahead. I'll toss these 16-inch softballs at you.
I barely fly Delta now. I'm a little scared of Delta, the TSA and everything. I think the woman he puts on the moon, my guess, it'll probably be Nancy Pelosi. It'll be the first one he sends up there. You know, I'm not into that, the moon. I think we're wasting a lot of money up there. There's a lot to do here. $28 billion is a lot. I mean, the space program so far, we've gotten Velcro and Tang. So I'm not sure really it pays off. Elon Musk, the private sector, has been exploring space. Let the private sector do it. I mean, I'm not a big fan of that. I know it's big for Florida. A lot of people like the space program. It's been a long time. 1969, men walked on the moon, and here it is 2020, and men are walking on eggshells.
And that's no yoke.
No.
Very nice. And by the way, I got your Tang reference, but the Taylor Swift sort of went over my head.
Yeah, she's
part of the demo, part of the demographic, as we say in the broadcast business. Ron Hart, thank you.
Get some of the younger people around the studio to explain to you.
All right, Ron, thank you and good night.
Good to see you.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
An attorney for Breonna Taylor's family said that they are outraged and insulted by a grand jury's decision not to charge any Louisville police officers directly with the death of Breonna Taylor, the 26-year-old EMT who was shot and killed inside her own apartment. Well, today the family's attorney called the proceedings a sham, pointing a finger at the Kentucky Attorney General.
When you think about they had wanton endangerment for the white neighbor's apartment, the bullets going there, but not for the bullets going into Breonna Taylor's body. It underscores what I've said many times. We seem to have two justice systems in America, one for black America and one for white America.
You know, attorney Chris Stewart is familiar with several high-profile cases like Breonna Taylor's. He represents the families of Ahmaud Arbery, George Floyd, and Rayshard Brooks. Well, today, he sat down with Morning Rush anchor Sheba Russell to give some perspective on Taylor's case.
We heard from the attorney general yesterday talking about how the charges of manslaughter and reckless homicide was brought before this grand jury. People are having a hard time wrapping their heads around what actually happens in these secret proceedings here. Are the attorneys representing the Taylor family right to say that there's some sort of cover-up that was happening here in the proceedings in which the evidence was presented to the grand jury?
You know, I think from watching everything yesterday and watching the attorney general's press conference, it's just clear that Attorney General Cameron had already made his mind up about what he wanted to happen before he took it to the grand jury. To get up there and say he still doesn't know if one of Hankins's bullets actually hit her, he didn't address the other officers that were on the scene and if there's body camera footage, to rely on one witness who changed his mind after three interviews and said that they did announce themselves, but there's 10 that said they didn't. It makes no sense. I mean, it shows where he was trying to go. A grand jury can only do what you give them. So that's the horrific part.
A two-day grand jury proceeding, unusual or the norm?
Well, it depends on how much evidence is going to be given to them. You know, right now with COVID, times are shorter, longer. You know, there's nothing odd about that, but it's just odd from his presentation about what he still doesn't know, but yet took it to a grand jury and immediately had already in his mind cleared the officers for use of force.
Do you find this wanton endangerment charge to be odd?
Well, I find it odd that no one to this day has been charged in Breonna Taylor's murder. The neighbors received more justice than she did, even though 32 shots were fired, none hit her boyfriend who had the weapon, and six hit her.
and none hit the neighbors as well. What are the next steps here, Elchris Stewart?
They just have to see if the federal government is going to do anything. They can still bring charges. Mr. Cameron has already made it clear that he's done. And I know a lot of people are upset because they're saying that he did this to fulfill promises to the police department. And we just don't know. We have to wait for the federal government, but it just truly shows the power of the prosecutor and if they've already made up their mind on what they're going to do.
We're running out of time here, but before we go, if you were representing Taylor's family, what would you tell them this morning?
Just stay strong. Keep the faith, and we mourn the loss of their daughter.
All right. Attorney Elchris Stewart, managing partner with Stewart Miller Simmons Trial Attorneys. We thank you for your time.
By the way, we have this full interview and much more posted right now on 11 Alive's YouTube page, including extended interviews with people who tell us why they decided to protest last night in Metro Atlanta.
Well, your 11 Alive storm trackers are watching the moisture from what was Tropical Storm Beta work its way in our direction. And notice how where we had that dry air shown by the blue colors on the map, it was in place and then it moved out, and we're seeing all that yellow on the map and orange, and that is much more moisture. And it's all because of Beta, now post-tropical, moving Northern Alabama and ahead of it, bringing in quite a bit of rainfall. We've already had almost an inch at the airport, and more is still to come overnight and a little bit more tomorrow as well. So as we come in a little Alabama, and that is the line that continues to be pretty strong here as it slowly pushes to the east, getting ready to move into Randolph and Cleburne counties as we speak. So it is on their doorstep right now, actually already moving into the west side of those counties. And we'll see it moving across the Georgia border, the Georgia line, as we head into around 10:30, 11 o'clock at night, when the heaviest rain will move on in here. So we're seeing storms coming in here and the north is in towards LAJ and Blue Ridge as well, and a few showers around the Athens area too.
At 12 years old, most kids are obsessing over their latest TikTok video, but a Marietta boy is focused on finishing college. He's already a sophomore at just 12 years old. Latasha Givens introduces us to the young man who's been defying expectations since he was a baby.
This is Caleb Anderson learning sight words. But before he could verbally communicate, he learned sign language.
And by 9 months old, he was able to sign over 250 words. And by 11 months old, he was speaking and reading.
And this is Caleb at two, reading the United States Constitution.
Of the United States.
Claire and Kobe Anderson say they soon realized their first child was special.
As we started to interact with other parents, and you know, had other children, then we started to realize how exceptional this experience was, because we had no other frame of reference.
By age three, Caleb qualified for Mensa. When he joined at five, his family says they were told he was the youngest African-American boy to be accepted at the time. Caleb whizzed through elementary, middle, and high school.
And he said, Mom, I'm bored. This is not challenging. It's really not helping me grow in my learning. It's like, I think I'm ready to go to college.
Now he's 12 years old and just started his sophomore year at Chattahoochee Technical College.
What was it like being a freshman in college at your age?
It was exactly how I expected it to be if I was like 18 or something.
Because of his age, Dad has to chaperone him on campus.
So you've had to go back to college basically with him?
Yes. Yeah. Go back to college, you know.
But he is not Caleb's study buddy.
He's actually far surpassed me in math, so I can't help him anymore. I mean, seriously, he's in calculus too now.
The Andersons have two other children, Aaron and Hannah, who are also gifted. While Caleb is outscoring his college classmates, his mother says there are more exceptionally gifted children like Caleb than we may think.
I think people have a negative perspective, a negative thinking when it comes to African-American boys. And I felt as that there are many of other Calebs out there, mm-hmm. But they don't have the opportunity or the resources.
For many, registering to vote takes seconds. For some, it's a goal that takes years, sometimes decades, to achieve. Why one woman isn't taking her registration for granted.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscast, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say...
All right, welcome back, everyone. You know, for many of us here in Georgia, it just takes minutes to vote. We can do it online, and we can do it from the comfort of our homes. But for some people, it's decades in the making. Absolutely. For this young lady here, Bellaline Rose Davies became a citizen this week in Gwinnett County. She came to America from Liberia. That's where she actually started. She says that she went through a lot of trouble trying to get to the point where she could vote. She says she almost faced homelessness. She was almost deported, but finally, she qualified to vote. Now you are a U.S. citizen. So what does that mean to you, and what's a priority for you?
I just want to say, this means this. The first thing I received today was my registration to vote. When I sat down, I looked at the paper, I was like, yes, yes, yes. So that means so much to me because, you know, at this, time in our society, everyone wants to have a voice.
Yeah, it took her 26 years to get to that point where she qualified to vote. Now, the numbers show more and more people in Georgia, just like Davies, are looking to make their voices heard at the ballot box. Voter registration in Georgia is up 9% from December of 2018 with more than 7 million voters eligible to cast their ballot this November. The numbers are growing, particularly in minority populations, with a 21% increase among Hispanic voters, 18% for Asians and Pacific Islanders, and 16% for Native Americans or Alaskan Natives. There is also an increase in Black voters, up 8% since 2018. So here are some important things to think about, some important dates here, folks. If you also want your voice heard on Election Day, October 5th is the last day you can register to vote in the November election. A week later, early in-person voting begins. If you want to vote by absentee, you have to request a ballot by October 30th, and then Tuesday, November 3rd, is Election Day. 11 Alive is doing everything that we can to make sure your vote is secure, that it's heard. For a list of important dates and more election resources, just head to 11alive.com/vote, and you can also find information you need on the 11 Alive app.
Well, just about an inch of rain has fallen already this evening across the Atlanta area, and parts of North Georgia have seen even a little bit more than that. And the main line that's going to be moving in as we head into the late night and early morning hours, that's going to bring in even a little bit more. And that's what's associated with a post-tropical depression, Beta. The National Hurricane Center has written their last advisory on Beta, but it continues its north-northeast movement here right along this frontal boundary, and that's going to kind of be the focus of activity, I think, as we head into the overnight hours, as it's going to want to funnel right along that line along I-20. So in comes the heavier downpours in Claiborne County and into Randolph County right now, bringing in some lightning there on the west side, stretching down towards Montgomery. And ahead of that, we're seeing the showers continue to develop ahead of that main line. It's kind of a slow moving line right now, so it's going to take its while to work its way on in here. On the parts of the line, we've seen like 3 inches an hour in this one cell that we queried, that's just to the southwest of Randolph County here, west of Milltown, 3 inches in an hour. If it were to rain for a whole hour in that one spot, they could see 3 inches. So that's a pretty good rainmaker along portions of the line. It's lighter here on the north side, producing around an inch and a third an hour as it approaches the Georgia line. So showers out ahead of this. We're seeing them in Thomaston, stretching on up through Roswell into Calhoun, Dalton, into Ellijay and Blue Ridge, and we're waiting for that main line to come in, most likely right around midnight. So the Storm Prediction Center giving the best chance for severe storms. It's at level 1 out of 5 levels, so an isolated risk in southeastern Alabama and into Randolph County as well. That includes Randolph County. General thunderstorms for the rest of us, and that continues through tomorrow as well, with the best chance for severe by tomorrow to the east of us. So kind of a dodging a bullet here. Our threat is very low to see any severe, but we're definitely seeing the winds blow out there this evening, the gusty winds, and that's as this moisture moves in and the dry air moves out. And that was the dry air we were experiencing earlier on in the week, that fall, crisp, cool weather. And Jerry Rogers posted this from earlier in the week. I just had to post it, even though we're getting rain right now, because it was so beautiful with those sunflowers out there at Fawcett Farms. Thank you, Jerry, for posting that incredible picture. So looking out over Rome, you can see where the rain is coming down. The wind is indeed blowing, and those winds are going to continue to be pretty strong in the next few hours, up around 20, 25 miles per hour, maybe 29 miles per hour, even in Blairsville. And that continues into the early morning hours here as we head after midnight, right around 25 miles per hour in Blairsville, 29 miles per hour in Dalton, as that circulation moves right along that frontal boundary in the overnight. So we'll continue to see those gusty conditions, maybe a few limbs down yet tonight, nothing organized, but there could be a little bit of debris on the roadways in the morning. You expect to see the showers and heavy downpours throughout the overnight hours, and then they'll start to taper off after the morning commute, and then we'll end up seeing isolated showers and storms during the afternoon and evening. So in comes that main line as we head into the midnight hour, and those showers moving off to the northeast as we head into our Friday. Just a few isolated showers and storms. Lots of moisture left over, though, for some good dense fog for our Friday morning commute and our Saturday morning activities. And the heaviest rain, it looks like it's going to be off to our northeast as we head into the first part of the weekend. So rainy through the night tonight, gusty at times, and we're going to see those dense areas of fog, so be careful on the roadways. We have a 5 on the wasometer for Friday because it starts out pretty nasty. By the afternoon, things starting to taper off. It's slow to clear, though. I think we're going to be kind of in the fog for a while, so it will be foggy on our Saturday morning as well with a few sprinkles. Start to dry it out during the afternoon. A mostly dry weekend, just a 20% chance on Friday as a front moves in. That brings in more showers possibly on Monday, 30%. And then temperatures cool down behind that front into the mid-70s, and we'll see more of those blue, beautiful fall skies coming once we get into Wednesday and Thursday.
All right, thanks a lot, Sam. Nearly 21,000 pregnant women have contracted COVID-19. Recent CDC data suggests pregnant women are more at risk of serious COVID complications necessitating ICU care and ventilation. Savannah Levin shares the story of one young mom that heartbreakingly drives home this issue.
Renee Bird couldn't wait to be a mom.
This was her first pregnancy, and she was very meticulous about all of her appointments and just keeping up. She was walking 2 to 3 miles a day, you know, just to try to stay healthy.
Her brother Roderick says despite taking every precaution, Renee fell suddenly ill 5 weeks from her due date.
She called us that she was heading to the hospital because she was coughing, and some of the phlegm she was coughing up had blood in it. They did a CAT scan of her chest, and they said that it looked like pneumonia and COVID. She said it was like trying to breathe through a straw. While I was still concerned, I was, you know, hopeful because, like, yeah, she was only 32.
This month, the CDC recommended pregnant women be classified as a high-risk group for COVID-19, as new data shows they're more likely to have serious complications from the virus. Renee's doctors performed an early emergency C-section, and baby Isaac was brought into the world.
I remember just telling her, hey, you know, you're going to pull through it. You're going to be okay. Even though she was hurting so much, I was like, hey, sit your mommy now.
Though he was premature, baby Isaac fought for life, even as Renee's slipped away, her lungs unable to fight the virus. She never got the chance to meet her son.
It was really hard the first time seeing him and holding him. But he's beautiful.
After several weeks in the hospital, Isaac is finally home. His family, determined to teach him all about the strong, brave woman who brought him into this world, the woman who wanted and fought for him to her last breath.
I just want him to know that his mom is an awesome person, and that same beauty that lives in her now lives in him. She was one of the most brilliant people I've ever met. She always knew how to make you feel better. And she always made you smile. Best sister anyone could ask for. I don't feel strong enough to handle it a lot of times, but she called me her superhero, so I kind of want to be a superhero for her and her son.
And though the pain is still so raw, this story so hard to tell, Roderick hopes the loss of his little sister resonates.
Wear the mask, social distance, wash your hands, you know, just let's really take care of one another, and let's do the best we can to get through this together. This story hurts, but I'm one of about 195,000 people that have a similar story. If this can help one person save one other person, then I think that her life had meaning.
At noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear, on 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Time was on at 10.
Army Rangers are taught to make tough decisions under pressure. That's why I picked up an enemy grenade and threw it away from my men and was awarded the Medal of Honor. America deserves strong, decisive leadership. For 40 years, Joe Biden has failed to meet that standard. He opposed taking out Osama bin Laden, and he's too silent as our cities and our nation's flag burn. Joe Biden is too weak to be our commander-in-chief.
Preserve America PAC is responsible for the content of this advertising.
Endurance wants to get you back on the road again, America. Protecting our employees and customers is our top priority, especially in these trying times. Even if you're driving less right now and your car is sitting idle, having the right vehicle protection is just as important as ever. Plus, cars are more prone to mechanical issues when they sit unused for long periods of time. Rest assured, we're here for you every step of the way. To learn more about our limited time relief program, including $300 off any protection plan, call 855-794-9461.
Introducing Checkers Smoky Barbecue Bacon Buford. Checkers' biggest, baddest, baconiest, barbecueiest burger yet. That's a lot of B words. Double perfectly seasoned patties. Double smooth Swiss cheese. Double the bacon with strips and crumbles. With all those tasty toppings on top. So big and bold, you should get a trophy for conquering it. It's a big Buford, but baconier. The new Smoky Barbecue Bacon Buford. Only at Checkers. Get Checkers delivered.
Karen Handel stood with this cardboard cutout and bragged about voting 98% with Donald Trump.
I have one of the strongest Trump support ratings.
Karen Handel supported Trump's plan to strip away protections for people with pre-existing conditions.
Like breast cancer,
high blood pressure, coronavirus.
I have one of the strongest Trump support ratings.
Karen Handel standing with him to take away our health care is nothing to brag about.
Every town for gun safety victory funds responsible for the content of this ad.
Looking for incredible speed and a great value? Xfinity gives you both. Xfinity delivers the fastest internet. Plus, with Xfinity X5, you get the amazing coverage, control, and protection you need. Call 1-800-593-2020 today to learn more or get started with an amazing deal on Xfinity internet for only $25 a month for 12 months. You'll get the best internet experience for your home with fast speed to power all your devices. But that's not all. With XFi, you'll even get control of your home Wi-Fi network, see who's online, and even pause Wi-Fi to connected devices. Just call 1-800-593-2020 to get started with Xfinity Internet for just $25 a month for 12 months. And ask how to get XFi Advanced Security for free when you get the XFi Gateway. That's a $72 a year value. Get the speed you want and the value you want, all risk-free with our 30-day money-back guarantee. Call 1-800-593-2020. Xfinity. Simple. Easy. Awesome.
11 Alive News Primetime on the ATL starts now.
Tonight at 10, a Clayton County man accused of going on a rampage, shooting three women and a child. How deputies tracked him down. And with so much riding on the November election, a Georgia man shares his cautionary tale why you should check your voter registration status right now. Plus, the nation's top health experts weigh in on the race for a vaccine. What Dr. Anthony Fauci said about politics today in his chat with Emory Doctors. We begin first tonight, a heartbreaking update in a deadly shooting that left a four-year-old child without a mother. Police say the accused gunman left that crime scene, then shot another woman inside of a Waffle House. Here's Hope Ford.
A two-county deadly shooting spree under investigation. Officers say it started in Clayton County when police say Carl Jordan shot a mother, grandmother, and four-year-old inside a home on Glen Court in the Hampton Lovejoy area Wednesday night. Police say when Jordan ran out of bullets, he took off. Then hours later in Henry County, investigators say Jordan shot a woman in the head at a Waffle House in McDonough. The motive isn't clear. Officers arrested Jordan Thursday morning.
It does appear that he has a criminal history. He did recently get released from prison somewhere near Chatham County.
Clayton County police are still trying to connect the dots in this case. Police believe Jordan had a relationship with the mother in the past, but didn't elaborate, only saying he is not the father of her child. The four-year-old and grandmother are going to live. When police found Jordan, they also found a gun, but haven't said if it was the weapon used in the four shootings. He faces three aggravated assault charges.
There is tension in cities across the country tonight, many feeling the weight of the decision not to charge three Louisville officers directly with the shooting and killing of Breonna Taylor. Instead, former officer Brett Hakison was indicted on lesser charges. Many in Louisville gathering around Ms. Taylor's memorial once again tonight. Last evening, we saw many people marching for justice in Louisville. Marches at one point turned violent, with two officers injured in a shooting not thought to be life-threatening at this point. The suspect now facing several charges for assault and endangering the crowd. The outrage over Breonna Taylor is stirring up memories of a similar case in Atlanta. 14 years ago, Atlanta police shot and killed 92-year-old Katherine Johnston when serving a no-knock warrant at her home, but it was the wrong one. Letitia Lance spoke with someone close to that case.
The tragedy that happened to Breonna just reminds me so much of the night that Katherine Johnston was killed.
It's been 14 years since Atlanta police officers burst into the Northwest Atlanta home of 92-year-old Katherine Johnston 2 days before Thanksgiving. Frightened, she grabbed her pistol and shot once to protect herself. Police returned fire 39 times, hitting her 6 times, killing her. Today, those close to the case see similarities between Johnston's death and the death of Breonna Taylor.
It's saddening, and in a lot of ways, it's maddening.
Officers entered Johnston's home on a no-knock drug warrant based on bad information. The officers tried to cover up their bad act by planting drug evidence in Johnston's home.
Truth of the matter is, it was the process. It was policy and procedure that killed Katherine Johnston, and it's the same thing for Breonna Taylor.
Unlike Breonna Taylor's case, the three officers who entered Johnston's home were all arrested and convicted on federal charges. There's still an active federal investigation in Taylor's case, which could lead to charges for the officers. Reverend Markle Hutchins believes Taylor's death presents a new opportunity for systemic change.
We have to focus on the solutions and not just being angry or upset, which we have every right to be. But at some point, you've got to turn your pain into power.
Katherine Johnston's case led to a citizens review board to serve as checks and balance for the Atlanta Police Department. Reverend Hutchins believes that part of the solution will also come from community policing. Tomorrow morning at 10:30, Breonna Taylor's family is hosting a news conference to respond to the grand jury indictment. We will continue bringing you the very latest developments in the case and efforts to create change in Georgia. All you have to do is tap on the 11 Alive app. All right, weather time, raining and dreary today. Got some heavy rain tonight, Samantha. It was an evening of adventure.
Yes, and it's still going on. We still have more heavy rain to come with this line that's just
on the other side of the Georgia line. And this is associated with Beta, now post-tropical Beta. The National Hurricane Center has issued their last advisory on it, but it continues to cause problems as it moves towards us along I-20 and bringing in this one last line, I think, is going to be the heaviest of the rain that we will see. And that will likely be right around midnight in West Georgia and then making its way across the Atlanta area during the morning hours here. And there is some lightning associated with that line. There's been some lightning along portions of the line. Haven't really had much lightning here with the showers we've seen across North Georgia so far. But I think once we get closer to midnight in the early morning hours, we may end up hearing some of those rumbles of thunder and seeing some of those flashes of lightning, as well as some very gusty winds. So that line will be making its way in towards West Georgia as we head towards midnight into Carroll County and Heard County, on up into Floyd County as well. And then it'll move to the east, bringing in some isolated heavy downpours along the line itself. There could be some thunder that we're hearing about that time, right around 2:30 or 3 in the morning. And those gusty winds too, gusting up around 25 miles per hour or at times, along with that center of circulation as it moves on through. So tomorrow morning, we will have showers for the morning commute, as well as some dense areas of fog. And the wind as that disturbance moves through as well overnight will be pretty gusty. So there may be some tree limbs down on the roadways or some small trees that have fallen. So just be careful as you make your way out with the visibility being limited by the fog. The wind having mainly brought some debris down into the road. So just watch for that early on. So coming up, we'll let you know what to expect for the rest of your Friday and what we can expect for the weekend as well.
There are potential pitfalls for voters this year, some you might never consider. Fulton County is adding 91 polling places in November. That means you might expect to vote one place when you're actually assigned to another, or perhaps you think your voter registration is up to date, but the state thinks that you have died, that you are a dead man or woman. We're laughing about mortality here tonight, ladies and gentlemen. 11 of Livestock Richards found that's what's happened to one man. They thought he was gone.
When Bill Clinton ran for re-election 24 years ago, Terrell Johnson cast his first ever vote as a young man in Augusta.
Been voting in Georgia basically all my life.
Johnson says he voted in Fulton County in the June primary and the August runoff. Applying for a November absentee ballot, he says he checked his registration online a few weeks ago.
And showed me as active, which of course I was.
But then he says he checked the Secretary of State's website again this week, and he says his registration was gone.
But they had me as being dead.
You don't appear to be dead.
Alive and well.
Johnson had gone to the Georgia Secretary of State's website at sos.ga.gov, clicked on elections, then you click on Where Do I Vote MVP, which stands for My Voter Page. A form comes up. Enter your name and date of birth. And it told me that I'm voting at an elementary school that's different than the place I've voted at for most of the last 20 years. It also tells me that the absentee ballot I requested in August was issued a week ago, though I still haven't seen it. You can find a link to all of this on 11alive.com.
Somebody must have been very close to my name, or almost exactly my name, had passed away. Yeah. And so they confused our voter registration records.
Johnson says it's easy to check your voter status online and that Fulton County is fixing his.
They were very helpful.
Does it shake your confidence any?
It shakes my confidence a little bit that those kinds of errors, like I say, could have happened to lots of other people and they would never know it until they showed up on election day.
And Johnson says he expects to vote absentee and says he'll keep checking until the site shows that the county has received his ballot.
Like the old Mark Twain line goes, reports of his death were greatly exaggerated. Georgia's new COVID-19 cases are declining again. Georgia's Department of Public Health reports more than 1,300 additional cases of the virus. That is slightly down from yesterday and below our 14-day rolling average. The steady fall is bringing us closer to the numbers that Georgia was seeing in June before the summer surge. The number of COVID-19 patients in the hospital also remaining steady. There have been around 1,400 people being treated for COVID for much of the past week. That's about 10% of all patients currently receiving treatment at Georgia's hospitals. Dr. Anthony Fauci joined doctors from Emory University for a virtual roundtable to discuss COVID. And they were talking about building trust in the midst of misinformation and the very latest on the vaccine developments. There was a heavy focus on the rush to find a vaccine. Dr. Sanjay Gupta of CNN asked Dr. Fauci to explain the vaccine approval process and if politics will come into play this 24 hours after the nation's top health officials testified on Capitol Hill saying their decisions are guided by science and not politics. Dr. Fauci echoed those sentiments today, saying that safety is the top priority. If the FDA recommends waiting before authorizing a vaccine, he agreed that would be for the best.
I rely very heavily on the decades of experience of the FDA scientists who say we should do this. And therefore, I would have to lean heavily on their side and support them.
We keep track of the latest COVID-19 numbers and trends every day. We even break it down county by county. You can find it all in the coronavirus special section on 11alive.com or the 11 Alive app. Sparking debate, a high school football announcer makes some controversial statements about COVID-19. Now parents want some answers from the school district. Uh-oh.
And footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during primetime. We're committed to giving you facts.
New at 10, some high school parents in Jackson County are upset over what they call racist comments from a football play-by-play voice. Shanu Herr went straight to the school district trying to get some answers to the story.
It was at this football game in Jefferson, parents of students at Jackson County Comprehensive High School say the game announcer caught them off guard. They say he asked fans to wear masks to prevent the spread of the Chinese virus in reference to COVID-19.
I saw families that I knew that were Asian just literally hold their heads down and just look toward the ground, and I knew exactly what they were thinking.
Susan Martin says while some parents laughed, she didn't find it funny at all, so she sent a complaint to the superintendent.
It's not okay for an announcement like that to be made over the loudspeaker.
One of those parents Martin talked to says her son is on the football team. She didn't want to be identified, but sent this text message to 11 Alive saying, I couldn't help but feel like there was a target on my back. For what? Because I'm Asian, my son and daughter are Asian. Like I'm to blame for the virus. This behavior just condones hate crimes like it's okay. Jackson County Schools Superintendent Dr. April Howard told 11 Alive the district and school have addressed the situation with the volunteer announcer and added, Jackson County Comprehensive High School prides itself on providing a very inclusive environment. The unfortunate use of that term in no way represents the feeling or climate of the school or school district.
I don't believe that everybody at Jackson County feels that way. I believe it was an off-the-cuff remark that does not represent our school.
According to the U.S. Census, Jackson County's population is 2% Asian, and Martin wants all families to feel accepted.
The number of new COVID patients may be falling, but the number of people heading to the hospital to be treated for the virus has remained steady, about 1,400 a day right now. And that has frontline workers like Wilbur Kennedy exhausted, not only with the work, but with the sacrifices his family is making.
We're right in their face doing the intubations on the ventilator.
Despite the risk, Kennedy says his wife and three boys wanted to stick together, even if it meant staying apart from others.
My boys can't go and see their grandmother. And also my neighbor, we had to sever that relationship. I used to take my scrubs off at home in the garage. Now there's the change of clothes and this whole scrubbing out all the way to the shoes. The question is always, am I taking this to my family?
Tonight on Up Late, what the CDC now knows about the virus's impact on healthcare workers and what Kennedy says is helping them get through it all.
Joined again by meteorologist Samantha Moore. Here we are rolling not that far away from October. So the seasons, they certainly are changing. And with that, oftentimes in Atlanta, and I'm not a meteorologist, but I play one on TV sometimes. sometimes when we see the seasons change, we get rain.
This is often the case.
How's that?
I like it.
Oh, wow. The Weather Channel has just called me offering me no, they're not offering me anything.
Sorry about that, Jeff. I have noticed the leaves on the trees changing. There are just a few tinges of fall, which is very exciting to see. Yes, area of low pressure, that was Beta. And, you know, by the way, the tropics, very quiet after a very active. Last week, we had so many storms on the map, you just couldn't even fit them on there. And now there is not one active tropical system. And this is post-tropical Beta, what is left of Beta, moving in towards West Georgia right now with a line of heavier downpours. So we're watching that approach, moving in through Randolph and Cleburne counties right now in eastern Alabama. And just bringing in a few showers ahead of it. We've had some heavier downpours, but right now, most of the showers from Peachtree City into Atlanta, Alpharetta, into Cherokee County, Fannin County, Gilmer County are on the lighter side. The heaviest rain, though, moving in towards Rome, moving in towards Lafayette at this hour, and then that line extending down into eastern Alabama. So we're definitely going to be watching that. Check out these temperatures today. 68 are high after morning low of 64. That's 12 degrees below average, and we picked up almost an inch of rain so far. Rain is still coming down in Rome. You can see it dripping off the street lights here. The flags have been blowing around as well as the winds have been gusting. Hey, this is Kimberly Morris's video, one of our 11 Alive storm trackers on our Facebook page. She posted this in Canton. She posted a couple pieces of video today showing these big raindrops coming down in her beautiful yard there in Cherokee County. Very nice, Kimberly. Thank you for showing us the rain in your neighborhood. So what we're watching tonight is going to be the rain continuing, especially throughout the early morning hours. It could be coming down pretty heavily at times. Could have some rumbles of thunder. I think probably most likely between around 2 and 3 in the morning. And then continuing in through the morning commute, we could see some of that rain along with some very dense fog. So that'll be the start of tomorrow. It'll be widespread overcast. We'll have some fog around. And then we have a chance for a few isolated showers and storms during the afternoon, but I really think the main event has been this evening and into the overnight tonight. So here it comes. There's that line that's going to be crossing over as we head into the midnight hour from Rome into Carrollton and then into Noonan as we head into like 2, 3 in the morning. There will be some heavier downpours in spots. Some spots could still see maybe a half an inch to an inch of rain as this line moves on through, dumping in some very heavy rain in a short period of time. So the morning commute's looking gray. It's looking rather wet, not downpours at that point, I don't believe, across most of the Atlanta area, but we'll have some showers around. And then by lunchtime tomorrow, still seeing the showers moving in behind that center of circulation. And by the evening hours, still cloudy and gray across most of the Atlanta area. But I think we'll end up seeing conditions kind of tapering off as we head into the beginning of the weekend. So it looks a little foggy on Saturday morning with a few showers around, but I think for the most part we'll be dry. The winds will be picking up the next few hours. Could see those winds gusting up to around 25 miles per hour or so. So tomorrow a 60% chance to start in the morning, tapering off throughout the day. We'll have a lot of fog on our Friday and Saturday, mostly dry on Saturday, although the clouds are going to be slow to clear. 20% chance on Sunday as a front approaches, and then we'll see that front bring in a 30% chance on Monday, and then that front ushers in cooler air once again, feeling crisp and fall-like with beautiful fall-like sunshine on our Wednesday and Thursday. Hey, your story today, Jason Bonner in Helen, Georgia, the clouds and the rain that he saw there in the North Georgia mountains and beautiful scenic Helen. So we want to see your weather wow moments as well, and the easiest way to share them is on the 11 Alive Storm Tracker Facebook page. Just go and request to join the group now.
Saturday Night Live returning next weekend. It's first show of the Rockefeller Center since the start of the pandemic, and a familiar host. Chris Rock will host the 46th season premiere, third time hosting SNL, and Megan Thee Stallion will be there. You can watch it next Saturday, October 3rd, on 11 Alive. A 12-year college sophomore's academic journey is an amazing one. This kid is on his way. He's already there. We'll hear from him and his family coming up next.
This to help people, or are you doing this to make money, or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscast, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people, or are you doing this to make money, or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
Marietta Boy made history as one of the youngest African Americans accepted into Mensa. And now at 12, he's already a sophomore in college. Caleb Anderson's parents say at just 9 months old, he could communicate 250 words in sign language. By two, he could read the U.S. Constitution. He joined Mensa at 5, and now at 12, Caleb is starting his sophomore year at Chattahoochee Technical College. While he is unbelievably gifted, his parents say there's a lot more black kids like him waiting to be discovered.
I think people have a negative perspective, negative thinking when it comes to African-American boys. And I felt as that there are many of other Calebs out there, but they don't have the opportunity or the resources.
Caleb's student life is a family affair. Because of his age, his father has to chaperone him on campus. I'm threatening my 18-year-old to do that next year. That's popular in my house. Coming up, an attorney who has represented several high-profile cases from Ahmaud Arbery to George Floyd. He weighs in on the grand jury's decision on Breonna Taylor's case.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
An attorney for Breonna Taylor's family says that they were outraged and insulted by a grand jury's decision not to charge any Louisville police officers directly with the death of Breonna Taylor, a 26-year-old EMT who was shot and killed inside her apartment earlier this year. Today, the family's attorney called the proceedings a sham and pointed a finger at the Kentucky Attorney General.
When you think about they had wanton endangerment for the white neighbor's apartment, the bullets going there, but not for the bullets going into Breonna Taylor's body. It underscores what I've said many times. We seem to have two justice systems in America, one for black America and one for white America.
Attorney Chris Stewart, familiar with several high-profile cases like Ms. Taylor's. He represents the family of Ahmaud Arbery, George Floyd, and Rayshard Brooks. Today, he sat down with Morning Rush anchor Sheba Russell to give some perspective on Taylor's case.
We heard from the Attorney General yesterday talking about how the charges of manslaughter and reckless homicide was brought before this grand jury. People are having a hard time wrapping their heads around what actually happens in these secret proceedings here. Are the attorneys representing the Taylor family right to say that there's some sort of cover-up that was happening here in the proceedings in which the evidence was presented to the grand jury?
You know, I think from watching everything yesterday and watching the Attorney General's press conference, it's just clear that Attorney General Cameron had already made his mind up about what he wanted to happen before he took it to the grand jury. To get up there and say he still doesn't know if one of Hankins's bullets actually hit her, he didn't address the other officers that were on the scene and if there's body camera footage, to rely on one witness who changed his mind after three interviews and said that they did announce themselves, but there's 10 that said they didn't, it makes no sense. I mean, it shows where he was trying to go. A grand jury can only do what you give them. So that's the horrific part.
A two-day grand jury proceeding, unusual or the norm?
Well, it depends on how much evidence is gonna be given to them. You know, right now with COVID, times are shorter, longer. You know, there's nothing odd about that, but it's just odd from his presentation about what he still doesn't know, but yet took it to a grand jury and immediately had already in his mind cleared the officers for use of force.
Do you find this wanton endangerment charge to be odd?
Well, I find it odd that no one to this day has been charged in Breonna Taylor's murder. The neighbors received more justice than she did, even though 32 shots were fired, none hit her boyfriend who had the weapon, and six hit her.
And none hit the neighbors as well. What are the next steps here, Elkris Stewart?
They just have to see if the federal government is gonna do anything. They can still bring charges. Mr. Cameron has already made it clear that he's done, and I know a lot of people are upset because they're saying that he did this to fulfill promises to the police department, and we just don't know. We have to wait for the federal government, but it just truly shows the power of the prosecutor and if they've already made up their mind on what they're going to do.
We're running out of time here, but before we go, if you were representing Taylor's family, what would you tell them this morning?
Just stay strong. Keep the faith, and we mourn the loss of their daughter.
All right.
We have the full interview and much more posted right now on the 11 Alive YouTube page, including extended interviews with many who tell us why they decided to protest last night in Metro Atlanta. Nearly 21,000 pregnant women have contracted COVID-19. Recent CDC data now suggesting that pregnant women are more at risk of serious COVID complications necessitating ICU care and ventilation. Savannah Levin sharing the story of one young mother, and it heartbreakingly drives this issue home.
Renee Bird couldn't wait to be a mom.
This was her first pregnancy, and she was very meticulous about all of her appointments and just keeping up. She was walking 2 to 3 miles a day, you know, just to try to stay healthy.
Her brother Roderick says despite taking every precaution, Renee fell suddenly ill 5 weeks from her due date.
She called us that she was heading to the hospital because she was coughing, and some of the phlegm she was coughing up had blood in it. They did a CAT scan of her chest, and they said that it looked like pneumonia and COVID. She said it was like trying to breathe through a straw. While I was still concerned, I was, you know, hopeful because I guess she was only 32.
This month, the CDC recommended pregnant women be classified as a high-risk group for COVID-19, as new data shows they're more likely to have serious complications from the virus. Renee's doctors performed an early emergency C-section, and baby Isaac was brought into the world.
I remember just telling her, hey, you know, you're gonna pull through it, you're gonna be okay. Even though she was hurting so much, I was like, hey, sit, your mommy now.
Though he was premature, baby Isaac fought for life, even as Renee's slipped away, her lungs unable to fight the virus. She never got the chance to meet her son.
It was really hard the first time seeing him and holding him. But he's beautiful.
After several weeks in the hospital, Isaac is finally home. His family, determined to teach him all about the strong, brave woman who brought him into this world, the woman who wanted and fought for him, to her last breath.
I just wanted to know that his mom is an awesome person, and that same beauty that lives in her now lives in him. She was one of the most brilliant people I've ever met. She always knew how to make you feel better, and she always made you smile. Best sister anyone could ask for. I don't feel strong enough to handle it a lot of times, but she called me her superhero, so I kind of want to be a superhero for her and her son.
And though the pain is still so raw, this story so hard to tell, Roderick hopes the loss of his little sister resonates.
Wear the mask, social distance, wash your hands, you know, just let's really take care of one another and let's do the best we can to get through this together. This story hurts, but I'm one of about 195,000 people that have a similar story. If this can help one person save one other person, then I think that her life had meaning.
President Trump says he will announce his Supreme Court appointment on Saturday to replace the late Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Joining me now is national columnist Ron Hart. Ron, the Supreme Court, by definition, is not supposed to be political, but it's folly to believe that that is the case. How does this all play out? And shouldn't both parties be ashamed of how they have treated the court over the last couple of years?
I think you're right, Jeff. I think I wouldn't be surprised if the San Francisco Ninth District Court of Appeals overturns her death and says she didn't die. So I don't think the Democrats have the high moral ground here. Neither do the Republicans. It is pure political power. And in this case, the Republicans control the Senate, and they can get whoever they want in there, especially with Mitt Romney on board right now.
A few of my Democratic friends say that Ruth Bader Ginsburg on her deathbed said she didn't want her seat to be filled until after the election. My Republican friends say that's an outright lie. She never said any of that. So, I mean, that's another example of all of this.
Yeah, the Constitution is not a wish list. The Constitution is pretty firm in what it says it can do. The president appoints, and the Senate advises and consents to it. So it's a pretty easy process. It'll probably get done between now and year end. It'll be a woman, I'm pretty sure. Trump's been interviewing a lot of women. Trump's a little bit different in his vetting process. Trump has a swimsuit competition in his vetting process. Unique to other presidents.
I'm sorry I'm laughing at that. We know you love award shows. The Emmy Awards, Country Music Award shows went on virtually. Is that a sign that perhaps the apocalypse is upon us?
Well, with COVID and everything and civil unrest and racial strife, you got recessions, you got COVID. It's good to see the celebrities take time to honor themselves. But on Taylor Swift, I mean, the main thing about her is I like her shorter songs because they're over center. So she's kind of made the crossover between both genres, and she's back to country music right now. I'm just afraid someday that you and I will end up in one of her songs, and that would not be good for either of us.
See, unlike you, I'm out of the demo when it comes to Taylor Swift. I have really no clue about her other than I know she has lived in Nashville. That's about it.
Yeah.
Okay, we move on. NASA is laying out a $28 billion plan to submit to Congress that will return astronauts to the moon. President Trump serious about putting a woman on the moon. Would you like to go to the moon as well, Ron? Go ahead. I'll toss these 16-inch softballs at you.
I barely fly Delta now. I'm a little scared of Delta, the TSA and everything. No, I think the woman he puts on the moon, my guess, it'll probably be Nancy Pelosi. It'll be the first one he sends up there. You know, I'm not into that, you know, the moon. I think we're wasting a lot of money up there. There's a lot to do here. $28 billion is a lot. I mean, the space program so far, we've gotten Velcro and Tang. So I'm not sure really it pays off. Elon Musk, the private sector, has been exploring space. Let the private sector do it. I mean, I'm not a big fan of that. I know it's big for Florida. A lot of people like the space program. It's been a long time. You know, 1969, you know, men walked on the moon, and here it is 2020, and men are walking on eggshells.
And that's no yoke.
No.
Very nice. And by the way, I got your Tang reference, but the Taylor Swift sort of went over my head.
She's
part of the demo, part of the demographic, as we say in the broadcast business. Ron Hart, thank you.
Get some of the younger people around the studio to explain to you.
All right, Ron, thank you and good night.
Good to see you.
After months of lockdown and restricted travel, one airline helping Americans feel a little more comfort about taking to the sky.
Remember this time last week when we had about 8 storms here in the tropics? It was crowded out there. Well, now it's so quiet. You can't find a disturbance out here in the middle of the Atlantic. There are absolutely not, there's not one active tropical system right now. But we are watching post-tropical Beta, what's left of it anyway, moving in right now. It could bring in some heavy rain overnight. So coming up, we'll let you know when to expect the worst of the weather.
Braves still have a few games left in the regular season until the playoffs begin. We'll talk with the Braves analyst about what the postseason looks like for the home team.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscasts, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and
President Trump traveled to the Supreme Court today to honor the late Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg. As lawmakers in both parties are reacting to his refusal to commit to a peaceful transfer of power if he loses the election. Here's Alice Barr of NBC with the very latest from Washington.
Paying his respects to the late Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg today, President Trump was greeted by chants of vote him out. Amid growing outrage over his insistence on filling her seat before the election. Adding to the controversy today, the president's refusal to commit to a peaceful transfer of power if he loses the election. President Trump again claiming without evidence that a surge in mail-in ballots will lead to widespread fraud.
Will you commit to making sure that there is a peaceful transferal of power after the election?
Well, we're going to have to see what happens. You know that I've been complaining very strongly about the ballots, and the ballots are a disaster.
People are rioting. Do you commit to making sure that there's a peaceful transferal of power?
We want to have get rid of the ballots, and you'll have a very peaceful. There won't be a transfer, frankly. There'll be a continuation.
Furious reaction from Democrats.
Get rid of the ballots. Just let him stay in power for whatever illicit way he chooses to do so. That's what he's saying.
Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell leading a string of prominent Republicans pushing back against the president's words, insisting there will be an orderly transition. President Trump also acknowledging he wants to fill Justice Ginsburg's open seat before the election, which would cement a conservative majority, because he expects the election results to be challenged in the Supreme Court.
United Airlines rolling out rapid COVID testing beginning in San Francisco for travelers flying to Hawaii. United is the first U.S. airline to offer rapid testing. It begins October 15th. The airline hopes to expand testing to all of its major hubs and potentially for international travel. Flyers can either take a rapid test at the airport the day of their flight with results available in about 15 minutes or use a mail-in test at home prior to flying. Flyers will have to pay for airport rapid tests, which aren't cheap. They begin at $250. Home kits will be $80 and will have results in about 48 hours. Planning a trip this fall? Google Maps wants to help you check the spread of coronavirus in states, counties, and some cities. If you click on the layer, it shows you a color-coded map with a 7-day average of confirmed cases. The label indicates the rate is going up or down. The new feature rolls out on Android and iOS this week.
Well, we're continuing to watch what's left of Tropical Storm Beta work its way in our direction tonight. So it's brought in some pretty good showers so far, with that southerly fetch coming in off the Gulf, a warm front in place, and what is left of Beta moving to the east right along that boundary itself. So we'll end up seeing some heavy downpours as this line works its way out of Alabama. In the meantime, we've had our share of showers from Thomaston into Barnesville into Griffin, McDonough, and right now along North Georgia throughout the mountains, the rain has been fairly light in the past couple of hours, but now it's starting to pick up here in Lafayette, stretching down into Floyd County, into Rome, and then down in Buchanan. So we're watching that as that line approaches here, moving into West Georgia, and that rainfall rate will be picking up as we head into the next few hours. So as we take a look at this big picture, that chance for severe is mainly in southeastern Alabama tonight, and that's just a level one. That just means an isolated chance for severe, and that's in place for Randolph County yet the next several hours. And then tomorrow it shifts to our east, so general thunderstorms is what we are expecting here across the Atlanta area and North Georgia for tonight and into tomorrow. Looking out, you can see that we do have that drier air has moved out. That dry, crisp fall air earlier has been replaced by humid tropical air. And it was that dry air on the first day of fall that made for some incredible pictures from our storm trackers. This coming from Jerry Rogers, one of our storm trackers, visiting Fawcett Farms. 30 acres of sunflowers up there. That is just south of Amicalola Falls, so a very beautiful picture. Thank you, Jerry, for posting that. The rain is coming down right now in Rome. Check that out. We are definitely seeing the heaviest of the rain moving in through Floyd County right now. Winds gusting, and it is coming down with great big tropical drops at this hour. In the next 12 hours, the rain will continue to intensify here in the Atlanta area as that line moves in. That's the line that's moving through Rome right now. And so our rainfall rate's going to pick up between around 2 and 4 in the morning. Could have some lightning as that line pushes on through as well. And that'll continue into the morning commute along with some very dense fog. And then we'll start to see things break up a bit maybe a few peaks of sunshine during the afternoon, and just a chance for an isolated shower or storm. I think most of our Friday night football games will be dry. There'll be a few showers around, but I think for the most part, it won't be particularly wet. Heading into the evening, I should say late evening hours and towards midnight, that's when that line starts approaching Marietta into Carrollton and then into the Atlanta area during the daybreak hours. We'll still have some showers around for tomorrow morning's commute. Lots of dense fog, so you may need to leave yourself a little extra time to getting to where you need to go in the morning. And then during the afternoon, things start to break up. Still quite cloudy, but I think we'll see better conditions by tomorrow evening and into our weekend as well. The wind's blowing the next few hours, gusting up to around 25 miles per hour or so, and then weakening as we head through the day tomorrow. So foggy start to your Friday, 60% chance for showers, mainly in the first half of the day. Morning fog on Saturday, mostly dry on Saturday and Sunday. Temperatures in the low 80s. Frontal system moves in, brings in a chance for showers Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. And then behind that, it's looking like a nice, dry, crisp pattern with more sunny blue skies for our Wednesday and Thursday.
All Power 5 conferences will play college football this fall. The Pac-12 will start playing a 7-game conference-only schedule on November 6th. Their championship game will be played December 18th. Crazy. These just get crazier and crazier. All right, Braves with a chance to sweep the Marlins, a rain delay a couple of hours, another solid start for Ian Anderson. The Braves hope that he is in the rotation for years. He started with 5 scoreless innings, 4 strikeouts. Marlins just scored. They lead 1-0 in the 6th. Earlier today, Maria Martin spoke with Braves broadcaster Chip Carey as the Braves look ahead to the playoffs.
Whether it's 162 games or 60 games, the Braves proved they were the best team in our division this year, and that's something that should be celebrated.
It's a three-peat for the Braves. They're the champions of the East in 2020.
We don't know who the Braves are going to play in the postseason yet, but everyone likes to, you know, play the matchup game. Who would they match up best against? Do you have a team in your mind where you think, I want the Braves to see this team first?
No, because, that's an excellent point. You know, the old saying, be careful what you wish for. I think we all thought, hey, we'd like to match up with the Cardinals last year, and that didn't work out.
I think everybody that's going to be in this thing is going to be dangerous in their own way.
Freddie and Marcel, being in the conversation for NL MVP, we've got to talk about it because these two guys, they're pretty close in every statistical category. They've had fantastic years. This could be a year where the Braves finally get an NL MVP back.
We have a good chance, and if you were to ask me who I would pick, I'd be like telling me which kid I have to choose as my favorite. I'm not going there because they're both so deserving. I think the one edge that Freddie Freeman is going to have is that he plays every day defensively. Nothing against Marcelo Zuna. There are a lot of really worthy candidates, and as well as Freddie is going right now, if he can finish strong like Chipper did when he won the MVP, when he bashed the New York Mets up at Shea Stadium in the old days, I think that's going to go a long way toward Freddie getting an award that I think he certainly deserves.
Keys for the Braves this postseason would be what?
It's going to be different. The Braves are going to play the games much differently in postseason play than they ever have before. They're going to rely on their offense. They're going to rely on their bullpen. And if these guys can get through the lineup 2 times and give this team a chance to either be in the game or hold the lead, I really like the Braves' chances to not just win a series but have a deep run.
Yeah, I agree. Man, that's good news. Hawks minicamp is underway. They are one of 8 teams working out now because they missed the NBA playoffs. Trae Young says watching 22 other teams in the postseason is motivating him.
I don't ever want to not be in the playoffs again. We're going into year 3, and our chemistry is there. We're starting to learn different things, talk even more. Hopefully it clicks. So that's what I'm hoping going into this year.
All right, that's it for sports. We're back right after this.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear, on 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscast, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
That main line we've been tracking moving out of Alabama the last few hours is moving in through Floyd County, Harrelson County, and into Carroll County right now, bringing in some really good rain to Rome at this hour. You can see here in this downtown shot, lots of heavy rain coming off the streetlights and puddling up on the roadways there. And we've seen some gusty winds as well. Those winds will be picking up the next couple of hours as this line moves through across North Georgia. So expect to hear the rainfall picking up in most of our North Georgia neighborhoods as we head into the overnight hours. And then Friday, a 60% chance in the morning, lots of fog around, and a mostly dry weekend to look forward to. We'll see you on Up Late on 11 Alive.
From 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Today at noon on 11 Alive.
We are seeing that lack of smell or altered taste can be a symptom.
We answer your coronavirus-related medical questions. Because 11 Alive is where Atlanta speaks.
Televised newscast, not enough for you? Get even more at 11 Alive's YouTube channel, where you'll find uncut interviews, extended body cam footage, live streams of Atlanta's biggest trials, and more. Subscribe to 11 Alive today.
In times of great uncertainty, some things become more clear. The things we take for granted, the people we depend on daily. Here at 11 Alive, we'd like to say thank you. First responders, medical staff, sanitation workers, truck drivers, postal workers, and every brave Georgian doing their part to make a difference. We see you, we hear you, and we appreciate all that you do.
Let's start with a viral message going around. Quote, vast majority of people who died had ibuprofen Advil in their system. This message is fake.
We just bought 20 dust masks for $97.
Are you doing this to help people or are you doing this to make money or both?
Both.
Take this email sent to the Verify team. Is it safe to have your house cleaned by outside workers? The best practice is to limit guests to emergencies only.
We know things are changing every day, but we're here with you. Continuous COVID-19 coverage during Primetime. We're committed to giving you facts, not fear. On 11 Alive News Primetime, weeknights from 8 to 11 on WATF.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of